This is Grumpy Old Gamer coming to you today with a little bit of Black Desert Online gameplay for the video footage, but today I'm going to be doing another soundtrack recording of Negative Land's radio show Over the Edge, and today we're going to be doing a show from KPFA from 6/18/2004 entitled Word Receptacle, and there's going to be a lot of bad words in this broadcast, so it'll have an adult rating, but make sure you check it out and you like it. I do have permission from Don Joyce, written permission to recast his music, his band, his radio shows. I wrote to him back when I was a DJ in Second Life and I was setting up a virtual nightclub and I wanted to feature his art in my nightclub, and he wrote back to me that I shouldn't need permission because he didn't agree with the copyright laws, but I did have his permission to reproduce all of his art, his music, his bands, everything on the internet. So let's get into it. Here we go with Negative Land, Over the Edge, Word Receptacle.
You know how things begin. You tell yourself, hey, this is it. This is the beginning. And that's what it becomes for you, for me. That's because beginnings are arbitrary. They only happen when you tell yourself they're happening. Maybe that's why they happen the way they do.
This is Parental Guidance Radio.
Dirty word this and dirty word that.
Take one step outside yourself. The whole path lasts no longer than one step.
Welcome to Over the Edge, and, well, warning, where's my delay? Warning, well, warning, well, that'll have to do. Tonight's Over the Edge contains some extra-sensitive language, so turn us off if that becomes bothersome. In my opinion, obscenity and profanity are purely an issue of politeness. Nothing more, but nothing less. And we are not intending to be polite tonight. Listener discretion is advised. It's all about the FCC and the human words it is attempting to regulate. The regulation of politeness on the air. I warn you. Turn away now or forever hold your peace. And knowing you men out there, you will be holding your peace forever. Tonight it's Word Receptacle on Over the Edge. Get in the mix with a few words on this subject. 510-848-4425 is our international number. 510-848-4425. Redundant or gratuitous use of the usual bad words will get you cut off tonight, as always. Only I will get gratuitous or redundant. Get it? When your phone stops ringing, you're on the air. Don't say hello. It's Word Receptacle.
Avant Jésus-Christ, cette technique thérapeutique de la mort lente. Et la médecine moderne complique en cela la plus sinistre et crapuleuse magie.
This is as good a time as any. The one we're in.
This is Parental Guidance Radio.
Dirty word this and dirty word that.
As of now, there's a phrase. As of now.
This is Parental Guidance Radio.
Every beginning that's ever begun has had to begin here where we are. Now, as of now, this instant, within all the instances, where all the beginnings.
Accent. Access. Accompaniment.
Accompanist. Accredit. Achilles. Acoustics. Acquaintance. Actor.
Actual.
Very nice to hear from you tonight.
You love me, I know you do.
Hey, if you'd give me an email or a mailing address,
what?
You know, you might hear from me, or a phone number or something. You might hear
what?
From me once in a while to do a show.
What kind of show?
Any kind of show you want. Your talent is unquestionable here.
Throw away your stuff.
I'm able to come in and do a show about your experience?
Yeah, but you don't give me any way to contact you.
Well, why should I do that?
I don't know.
I'll tell you where you can contact me.
Send me something.
I'm not going to send you. You can go to People's Park and I'll be there. You know, this is where I made up right now.
So I'm hearing a bunch of elephants tonight.
You see?
Hello. Whoops, I almost said the forbidden word.
No.
At least I didn't cuss. Only Don Joyce can cuss tonight, and what he plays. Right, Mr. Joyce?
That's right, unless you're using it as a academically descriptive phrase or term or word necessary to make an insightful point about this type of important language.
Well, how will we know if we cross the line?
You won't.
You won't?
You won't, because there's no way. They don't tell you anymore.
What I mean is with you. I mean, if X caller makes an inappropriate stream of syllables, how will he know that he has crossed the line?
He won't. I will have to make a judgment call. What is redundant? What is gratuitous?
So if there's some creativity behind it, it'll stand a better chance of not meeting your condemnation.
Perhaps.
Well, I'll work up my courage.
Hard to say. My taste is unaccountable.
See, I used to be much more freewheeling with my language than I am now. I'm sure you remember that.
No, I never remember you as being very impolite.
Oh, I was not impolite. I just used to cuss once in a while.
Well, that's impoliteness.
It's impoliteness?
Yes. It is impoliteness. I don't know what else it is. It's just to curse is impolite, that's all. And it has, and it carries as much meaning as being impolite carries, which is, you know, it's fine to be impolite sometimes. It's justified.
I agree. Sometimes an attempt to be offensive is definitely impolite. However, in many respects, curse words have become a form of italicization.
As some of the material I'll play tonight says, it's an intensifier. It's used in language not to mean what it means in the dictionary, but to intensify other words.
Like if one was to take the letters FCC and
put a U in there, what do you got? Come on,
hey,
let's see.
That's pretty good.
Pronounced the same, FUCC.
I miss Gene Scott. He used to have Cuss U University.
He's on every night, you know.
On a shortwave.
No, he's on TV every night on Channel 4.
In the Bay Area?
In the Bay Area.
You lucky people.
Late at night, he does an hour or a half hour. He's almost gone. He's got cancer. He's working with God. He thinks he'll make it.
He's got cancer?
Oh, yeah, it's a recurring thing. And
of what?
I don't know.
His tongue? I'm sorry, I shouldn't joke about that.
You should see his new wife.
Oh, he's got a wife?
Oh, yeah, she's about, I'd say 18 to 21. And she does the singing she has a song at the end of every show in the beginning, and she does these songs.
Oh, how splendid. He's
it's a regular Citizen Kane thing. She cannot sing. She's just awful and worse than awful, horrible. And yet she's out there bravely, you know, singing these songs at the beginning and end of every show because, basically, she's his wife.
And everybody's afraid to say anything.
That's right.
The ultimate voice of the
That's right.
Heard.
Apparently he thinks she sings pretty good, and so everybody else does, too.
Yes, sir, they all say.
Otherwise, he has three big blackboards, and he fills them every show and doesn't erase them between shows, and they just pile up as a bunch of graffiti, every little speck of which he understands and knows what it means.
But you can't read it. It's illegible if you just come upon it.
That's right. It's just Jackson Pollock, you know.
Well, this is great. I'm so glad to know that he's progressing in his mental state.
Pretty much the same.
Well, he used to be...
He doesn't get angry anymore, and he's not quirky, and he's not weird. He doesn't go off on things. He just sticks to the Bible. It's strict Bible teaching. No more fun with the FCC or any of that kind of stuff.
No more monkey chant or anything.
No.
I've got the tape of him when he was cut off on his last 40 minutes on the air.
Oh, like this?
Hello?
Don't say that.
Oh.
That's worse than cursing.
Good hello. Is that better?
Slightly.
You can just start, really, with whatever your intent on getting on the air was.
But you, Dan.
Oh, I see. I see.
Hey, you ever been in a fight?
I consider that gratuitous.
Hey, you know what? You ever been in a fight?
It's not redundant yet, but I'm waiting.
Yeah. You know you want to go to People's Park, you son of a bitch? Hey, don't you try to say fuck you. I'm the one that says fuck you.
That's redundant.
No.
I've just got to ask,
Hey, would you like to know what General Patton had to say about profanity?
War is hell.
Well, I don't think he said that. As a matter of fact, I'm sure I don't know who said that.
Probably said something like it. Damn useful.
No, well, what he actually said was the reason why he liked the cuss is because it was the only way that he could make something stick. Okay, can you follow that?
Well, it's true. As cliched and familiar as all cursing is to everyone, it still gets your attention.
That's right. It makes something stick. It stands out.
It's
right away, it breaks away.
It's
I'm
an
sure a lot of people feel that. I'm trying to make something stick right now.
Yeah, I can just imagine what you got to make stick. Come on, let's have it.
All right, I know there's a little... Come on. What's the second part of that remark?
What? What are you talking about? So, anyway, that's what Patton had to say. But you have to understand that Patton, you know, that's 50, 60 years ago. And it was a different world completely. I mean, you couldn't.
Yeah, but what's the second part of that remark? Come on.
What
I know
remark?
You got one.
What remark?
Your
what
little
remark
about
you sound like you're working on
sick.
Something there. You're working on something.
Address.
You're profane. You see, there's a difference between impolite and being profane. And then the next step is vulgar. So, you know, and what comes after that, I'd have to think about it.
There is a part of our government that is charged with enforcing politeness. Enforcing politeness. It's a matter of law. And that's the Federal Communication Commission, which, among other things, has the thankless job of deciding which words and images can be put on radio and television.
Dirty word this and dirty word that.
The entertainment capital of this country is Las Vegas. What detraction that all support, all of the moralists. Well, up the Stardust, we have the Passion Play. Well, and then the Consistent, that's very good. Passion Play. What follows the Passion Play? Well, we're having Eugene Normandy, the New York City Ballet, Lottie Lanier, Monet exhibit. Is that the attraction in Las Vegas that all support? All of the censors, all of the senators, tits and ass is the attraction. I beg your pardon.
As you probably heard, there's been a new crackdown on indecency at the FCC in recent years. recent months. And the case that represents the biggest break with the past has to do with the singer Bono getting an award at the Golden Globes and saying effing brilliant on national television. In the past, the FCC has said...
Dirty word this and dirty word that.
That they were changing the rules. And what's not been talked about much is the reasons that they give for this change. These reasons get to the very heart of what a white society means. The FCC said basically, the F word must be stopped in nearly all instances. Because first and foremost, it harms children. So we wanted to check with an expert, to find out if in fact there is any scientific evidence that bad words hurt kids.
The Wall Street Journal called me the preeminent scholar of profanity. And the Boston Globe called me Dr. Dirty Words.
His other name, the one his mom gave him, is Timothy Jay, a professor of psychology and author of academic books with titles like Cursing in America and Why We Curse. A warning to listeners that in his interview we mentioned directly and indirectly a number of curse words.
Dirty word this and dirty word that.
He turns out to be very familiar with the basis of this FCC ruling.
Our whole obscenity law is predicated on this idea that exposure to obscene material will deprave or corrupt children. And we've had that in our law since the 1600s, but there's no evidence that a word in and of itself harms someone.
And all the endings for that matter. Come and go. Here, where we are, in this huge, immense moment, are all our yesterdays. See them, one next to the one before it.
Kitchenette is the attraction.
Next to the one before that.
Just tits and ass? No, an Apache team and tits and ass. Well, that's what I go to see, the Apache team.
Next to the one before that.
Well, there must be one hotel. Give me the second biggest attraction. More tits and ass. That's it. Tits and ass and tits, and tits and ass, and ass and tits and ass and tits and ass.
Simulacrum, not a real-life, cheap imitation. Coruscated distress, condition, or contradiction makes strange of. Brutal instances hiss and plague her.
I've done a number of studies over the years where we've gone into daycares and we've collected what kids say to each other, just kind of unobtrusively. I've also had informants go who worked at in summer camps, and we just write down everything that happens. We carry these little 3x5 cards around and write down the who, what, where, and when. And by and large, every normal kid knows how to swear. As soon as kids learn how to talk, I mean, we've got 2-year-olds in our sample saying 4-letter words. And
way back.
A lot of times they don't know what they're saying, but they are repeating what their parents and siblings say.
Going back as far as the eye asking why can see. Way back there, where we are now, you can see the crowds of memory from way back then. So far away back then in yesterday, that all the little histories we're made of begin to fade to a distant blur.
Whoa, you mean to tell me that Life magazine would devote 3 full pages to, how did you say that? That's an ass.
Let's really break it up there. Remember, we used to have a really staccato with nothing hanging. The rhythm, you know, just go words. Words.
Dirty word this and dirty word that.
Genocide, bruised, broken, locked in hallucination, excoriate their crime, speak out and beyond, menace Bodzil!
At this point, you want to insert your programming here.
I was just wondering if anybody had ever, compiled a list of, well, especially election year hot buttons in the media, as far as different TV shows and music, things of this nature that have, set politicians off. I would love to get a list of all of these different issues, especially as far as the election years go, and if anybody has compiled these, if they could possibly email them to davidvdiaz2@juno.com. Okay, I'm compiling them too, trying to make a documentary out of them.
Yeah, we'll make a documentary out of this. Isaiah 36:12, but Rob Shaka said, "Hath thy master sent me to thy master, and to thee to speak these words? Hath he not sent me to the men that sit upon the wall, that they may eat their own dung and drink their own piss with you?" King James Bible.
Sì, e l'anima intera quando lode, e la virtù di tutti quasi corre allo spirito sensibile.
Well, I... Oh, yes, right next to the article by Billy Graham and Norman Vincent Peale. And Nugget and Rogue and Dude and Gent. And myriads of other stroke books.
Full.
The antecedent to Playboy, National Geographic, where the African chicks in school. Hey, look at this man.
In the park. They basically got tired of writing full, uncommon, carnal knowledge. So they wrote down the abbreviated letters of the first letter of each word, making it an acronym that we all know today as, well, fuck. Does anybody have any idea where the word shit came from? Perhaps that is an acronym? What do you say, Billy?
Well, that may be the truth. I'll check it out.
So if I use this language in a creative way, as a better thing, and then you decide, who decides what's polite and what's not polite? Where does it say that I have to be polite to you? If I wanted to say, you know, shrimp this and flip that, you have no problem with it, but if I use the fuck word, then you get all your panties in a bunch. Why is that?
The word chick derives from chickadee, which was a slang term for woman, desired woman, which is at least as old as its use in the W.C. Fields film of the same name.
No, that wasn't the word.
But if it is the truth, you just can't put tits and ass nightly up in a marquee outside on the strip. Why not?
The single most popular curse word, by a huge margin, no other word is even close, among children aged 5 to 12, is the F word.
This is Parental Guidance Radio.
Why not? Because it's dirty and vulgar. That's why not. Titties are dirty and vulgar? Well, they're not to me, Jim. I like to hug them and kiss them.
fuck you. How about that? Is that?
No, really. Listen, I didn't mean to make a bad impression, right? We were supposed to be at the movies, but we were really up at the lookout, you know, looking over town. We had a giant bottle of Sky Vodka, and then like a bat out of nowhere, her parents call. We have to be at the movie theater in about 3 minutes, but it's about 10, 15 miles away. So we speed down there, driving on the road, fucking left and right. Oh, didn't mean to curse there. It just came out, you know. Anyways, pull up to the movie theater, pull into a spot, right? Her parents pull up right next to me. Her dad's in the passenger seat, waving with a smile. How fucking nice.
That was a good story. My favorite fantasy story is about the professor who said the word niggardly. And even though he was later able to demonstrate that it had nothing to do with the dirty word that people thought he was saying, that it was in fact a legitimate word that meant stingy or something along those lines, he was still dismissed. And so pretty soon this insanity of trying not to be impolite means you can't even say legitimate words that sound impolite. By the way, whatever happened with your jury duty, Don?
They didn't need me.
I just got a summons. I hope they don't need me either.
A long time ago, the F word was used for something else. It was actually to get permission to do something. See, the letters F-U-C-K stood for fornication under consent of the king. Well, these were olden times, of course. Sue, do you think you would need permission for something like that? At this time? In history? Well, of course not now, and of course, Susie, you're way too young for that. But at one time, people did need such permission.
All right, I don't need a parent to tell me that the word nigger is an obvious, overused racial slur. He could have used other words to describe his point. Maybe other words than racial slurs that are known well and obviously offensive to a large part of our population.
Well, in other words, what kind of echo?
You know, slowped, chink.
Hey, don't say those words. Those are nasty.
Anything like that, along those lines, basically that's what he's trying to say.
By the way, what do other groups call us these days? What are white people referred to as? You never hear those words.
Allah.
They must be something they call us. Or are we to assume that only the white devils actually make up...
Why do they call the white people howlies? Because when the tourists walk on the sharp lava, they say they howl. And I think I heard the word cracker used for white people, too.
When I was in high school, they used to call white people a coos, C-O-U-S, which I believe was derived from Caucasian. I was in a high school that was 95% of apparent African ancestry.
I remember white people being called honkies, too, but that was only on the Jeffersons.
No, I heard that term too, honkies. Otherwise, they would call us other nasty things. But I went to a high school where at Ravenswood High School, and I got to hear a lot of soul music. I got to learn about African American culture.
Yeah, somehow being called whitey doesn't seem to cut it.
Sometimes they call you white boy. Sometimes they call you cracker. Sometimes they say something gold coming through. Sometimes they just call you boss. They just say, hey, boss. You know, it's all the same. But we don't have no racism. It's all about classism. You green, that's it, man. You buy $10,000 tennis shoes, step out of a homeless person with them.
He used to weave a web, a tapestry of obscenity that's still floating over Lake Michigan to this day. Son, how did it happen?
Your dad, you know, we go way back.
It was.
You're avoiding me.
Poisoning me.
You're afraid of me. You know what? I've been down there at that little punch pad at your front door, crossing the supermarket.
Now, this is Big People Radio, so I want all you kids to go into the other room.
You remember Ronald Redfall, the metallurgical man?
To entertain yourselves with. Perhaps a little dancing and singing. So you kids all clap and sing along now, you hear?
Who is that back there? I'll never forget. What's his name? Do you remember? When did it happen? As of now, here where we are, in this huge, immense moment, are all our tomorrows. See them.
No, it's not the titties. You're not going to bait me. It's the words, the way you relate. I don't believe you. I believe to you it's the titty that's dirty. Because I will change the words in the marquee to tuckuses and nay-nays nightly.
You don't have any good amateur practice.
My tongue.
Ill shrieks ill, feeds on self, seethes, writhes under literalization of death, loathing itself, bloated on greed, more greed to slaughter, whatever gets in your way, land grab, more slaughter, divide, nullify, murder, slaughter, and disempower of
us. As far forward as the eye asking why can see, stretching out beyond the reachable, uncountable, with all their nights and days waiting, waiting with the yet to be, all those tomorrows. All those hopes and desires. Everything's gonna be perfect. You'll see. Could you come back this afternoon? Hope to see you soon. Here where we are. In this amazing come and go. Now is the only time anything can happen. Now is the only place where everything that's ever been is.
This is Earth Outlet 3D Turk KPFA and KPFB Berkeley KFCF Fresno. Listener sponsored radio.
Things begin. You know how things end. You tell yourself, hey, this is it. This is the ending. And that's what it becomes for you, for me. That's because endings are as arbitrary as beginnings. They only happen when you tell yourself they're happening. Maybe that's why they happen the way they do. Anytime you want them to. Could be this very moment. Right now.
Followed by the S word when they're about seven. Suck, damn, and Jesus get a lot of play in the summer camp data. Hell, bitch, bum, and ass do pretty well in the daycare data.
I just did a sample of 200 college students and asked them about, you know, what their parents did when they swore and how they learned how to swear and whether they were punished or not. And 96-97% of these kids, you know, grew up swearing, and most of their parents had rules against swearing, but most of their parents swore anyway in the house. And so everybody knows how to do this, swearing, and almost all kids do. And it goes on, you know, day after day with very little consequence.
Dirty word this and dirty word that. Dirty word this and dirty word that. Dirty word this and dirty word that.
X, Y, 0.
Go get me the guru. Who's made such a buzz? That Mr. Charisma, if ever there was. You know, he could help us.
How?
They say that he may. Might help us to find the simpler way.
I'm right.
He sits on his haunches. His brain starts to whir. A mumble of mantra begins to occur. What's he saying? What is it? The slippery shaman goes into a trance.
Look at him.
We circle around him. It looks like a dance. An easy-go feeling comes over the crowd. His whispery mantra is just the right loud.
Listen.
Mildred Pierce reporting. I was there. I saw it. I saw women thrown down on Fifth Avenue and raped in their mink coats by blacks and whites and yellows while street urchins stripped the rings from their fingers. A young officer stood nearby. Aren't you going to do something? I demanded. He looked at me and yawned. I found Colonel Bradshaw bivouacking in the Ritz. I told him bluntly what was going on. His eyes glinted shamelessly as he said, "Well, you have to take a broad general view of things." And that's what I have been doing, taking a broad general view of American troops raping and murdering helpless civilians. While officers stand around and yawn.
William died on August 2nd, 1997, at 6:30 in the afternoon from complications from a massive heart attack he'd had the night before.
Had it a long time, lady. It's the old army game, here to eternity. This license was dictated by considerations taken into account by prudent commanders throughout history. It pays to pay the boys off. Even the noble Brutus did it. Points with his left hand in catatonic limestone. The town is yours, soldier brave. Tacitus describes a typical scene. If a woman or a good-looking boy fell into their hands, they were torn to pieces in the struggle for possession, and the survivors were left to cut each other's throats.
He was 83 years old.
74.
I was with William Burroughs when he died. And it was one of the best times I ever had with him.
Mother-loving American army run by old women. Many of them religious. My God, hanging American soldiers for raping and murdering civilians. Old Sarge bellows from here to eternity. What the bloody fucking hell are civilians for?
Doing Tibetan Nyingmapa Buddhist meditation practices, I absorb his consciousness into my heart.
Soldiers pay. CO stands there and smiles. Just ahead is a middle western town on a river. 30,000 civilians. The CO points. It's all yours, boys, every man, woman, and child. God is nigh.
It seems.
Let's get us some civvies.
Like a bright.
Now, just a minute, boys. Listen to old Sarge.
Bright, light, blinding, but muted. I was the vehicle, his consciousness passing through me. A gentle shooting star went in my heart and up the central channel and out the top of my head to a pure field of great clarity and bliss.
I make the usual stupid scene, kicking in liquor stores, grabbing anything in sight. You wake up hungover in an alley, your bricks sore from fucking dry cunts and assholes. Your eye gouged out by a broken beer bottle. Yeah, you and your asshole buddy wanted the same piece of ass. No funny, Matt. Why not leave it like this? They go about their daily routines, business as usual, schools all open. See what I mean? And we just take what we want when we want it. See what I mean? See what I mean? See what I mean? See what I mean? See what I mean?
It was very powerful. William Burroughs resting in great equanimity and the vast primordial expanse of primordial wisdom mind.
We just take what we want when we want it. And we just take what we want when we want it. Cool and steady and easy and make them like it. The young lieutenant from camouflage sees what he means. Boys, swimming pools and locker rooms full of them. Getting it steady year after year. Now that's what I call pay.
I was staying in William's house, doing my meditation practices for him, trying to maintain the good conditions and dissolve any obstacles that might be arising for him at that moment in the boardroom. But he was not a completely enlightened being. I had great confidence in his capabilities.
I walked in thinking of this AA meeting and be another kind of a 12-step group. It seemed to be, well, God, you should have heard it. Actually, I'm glad you didn't hear it. It was the most foulest thing I've ever heard in my life. Oh, I strained even to try to describe you what it was really going on there. Everybody was screaming and jumping up and down, but they were all screaming swear words. There seemed to have the filthiest mouth in the world. Oh, honey. You just stumbled on the Tourette's group. It's okay. It's a neurological disease. Everything's all right.
Yeah, it's a neurological disease. They've been putting the tube, you stupid.
As a child, I remember songs that the kids would sing that would suggest dirty words. That one verse would end with, "She fell right on her," and the next verse would start with, "Ask me no more questions, tell me no more lies," or something like that. I can't remember many of the good ones, but I remember you'd get some adults just about to knock you on the head, and then they'd realize, oh, it's just a cute song, and you'd get away with saying all sorts of things.
I just basically wanted to complain about that last Tourette's is a terrible disease, and I've got it.
I don't come out with the swear words too much, but they have popped out, like in the middle of a Safeway sometimes. It's rather, it stinks.
When you gun down my child in Fallujah and torture my brother and put his head in a canvas sack, all I can say to you, soldier, is you better watch your back.
Meeting of International Conference.
This is the shittiest place you've ever been.
I'm Amy Miller, and I'm Roxanne Dallas, and we're thrilled from thespeakmagazine.com. I bet you're wondering why Summer of Love? If there's one thing in Vegas anyone can guarantee, it'll be a lot of this.
That's a little better.
Where's the legal ID, Don? You fucking forgot that. God damn it, you...
White bread.
Oh, shit, he's right. This is KPFA and KPFB in Berkeley, KFCF in Fresno. Dealing with all the bad words tonight.
White bread.
On word receptacle. And white bread, too.
Well, you're not an anti-Semit, that's point one.
Back and forth rocking begins to begin. And
mystery.
Don't call me boy, I ain't the kid.
See, I just don't, I don't get how I can be punished physically or psychologically or socially in class or at my workplace for vibrating my vocal cords in a certain pattern that some squares recognize as a bad thing.
I don't think you can there. I think
there's no real meaning to the word fuck or
you,
shit.
I think you can pretty much say anything you want in, outside, you know, in the outside world. It's only in broadcasting where it's a real problem.
Oh, well, a real problem. What kind of real problem is it really? Fucking hell, Don. Come on.
Well, it isn't a problem tonight, but ordinarily I'd have to cut you off and you'd be gone right now. That's
no.
The problem.
Come on, everybody, tell me what's the word.
Is kind of dirty word?
Yes, it is.
Meeting of international conference of technological psychiatry.
Lazy alcoholic junkie William.
Dr. Fingers Schaefer, to lobotomy kid, rises and turns on the conference the cold blue blast of his gaze. Gentlemen, the human nervous system can be reduced to a compact and abbreviated spinal column.
And I didn't allow any doubt to arise in my mind, because it might allow doubt to arise in William's mind.
The brain, front, middle, and rear must follow the adenoid, the wisdom tooth, the appendix.
I had to proceed fearlessly with absolute confidence. Now I had to do it for him. Watt went into William Burroughs' coffin with his dead body. On August 6, 1997, Tuesday at 1 in the afternoon, James Grauerholz and Ira Silverberg came to William's house to pick out the clothes for the funeral director to put on William's dead body. The clothes were in a closet in my room, and we picked out the things that would go into William's coffin and grave, accompanying him on his journey in the underworld.
I give you my masterwork, the complete all-American de-anxietized man. Blast of trumpets. Man is carried in naked by two Negro bearers who drop him on the platform with sneering brutality. The man wriggles. His flesh turns to a viscid, transparent jelly that drifts away in green mist, unveiling a monster black centipede.
Very little harm.
His favorite gun, a .38 snub-nose special, fully loaded with 5 shots. He called it the Snubby. This is very important, I said. William always said, you can never be too well armed in any situation.
Those people like him extremely well, or do they, whenever they can, rebel or plot at the end of SWAT? If he catches them then, either old or young, does he have them chopped in pieces, or hung, or shot? The Akund of SWAT. The Akund of SWAT. Do his people prig in the lanes or park? Or even at times when days are dark? Garage for the Akund of SWAT. Akund of SWAT. Does he study the wants of his own dominion? Or doesn't he care for public opinion?
Race, a culture.
The Akund of SWAT.
How much dirty the river.
To lose his mind.
Starve the
Do his
mother.
People show him pictures? Or anyone's last new poem? Or what?
Tighten the rope. Consummate a dark plan.
At night, if he suddenly screams and...
Decoration.
Waves of unknown stench fill the room, searing the lungs, grabbing the stomach. Schaefer wrings his hands, sobbing. Clarence, how can you do this to me?
Of his more than 100 world-class guns, it was his favorite. He's often wore it on his belt during the day and slept with it every night, fully loaded, under the bed sheet on his right side.
Greats, every one of them ingrates.
A gray fedora. He always wore a hat when he went out.
The conference start back, muttering in dismay.
And we wanted his consciousness to feel at ease dead.
I'm afraid Schaefer has gone a bit too far. I sounded a word of warning. Brilliant chap, Schaefer, but... Man will do anything for publicity.
Do they bring him only a few small cakes? Or a lot?
Or the acorn of swats?
And glee!
Does he live on turnips? Tea? Or tripe?
Oh!
Does he like his shawl to be marked with a stripe?
Done.
Or a dot? The acorn of swats?
Dump!
Swats. Does he like to lie on his back in a
degraded.
Boat? Like the lady who lived in that isle remote.
Moving.
Nabbed. Of swat.
Bloody handed, sir.
Is he
fired
quiet?
From a hilltop?
Or is making a fuss?
There's
is a steward a Swiss, or a Swede, or a Russ, or a Scot?
Sense of villain. We are safe.
Does he like to sit by the calm blue wave?
The
way. Or to sleep and snore in a dark
Live
green
down.
Cave. Or a grot.
Income of swats. Income of swats.
Does he drink small beer from a silver jug? Or a bowl? Or a glass? Or a cup? Or a mug?
Or a pot? The income of swats.
Income of swats. Does he beat his wife with a gold top pipe?
When she lets the gooseberries grow too ripe?
Gentlemen, this unspeakable and in every sense illegitimate child of Dr. Schaefer's perverted brain must not see the light. Our duty to the human race is clear. Man, he done seen the light, said one of the Negro bears.
Let me just read to you from the recent FCC decision about Bono using the F word. FCC Commissioner Kathleen Abernathy said about the decision against using the F word at the Golden Globe. She said, "Today we take a strong stand against indecency on our public airwaves and a significant step in protecting our children."
Are we rather stand condemned? Never, never topple, mock, deride the temple, political decorum.
What's your take on that?
Most 7-year-olds already know what that word is. Most 4-year-olds have heard it. I don't know what you're protecting them from. And most kids use this kind of language.
I'm not gonna lie, I've said some of them out loud. I hear it all the time in the hall and stuff, and I guess I'm used to it.
Cause he runs a daycare. And then she has said, go upstairs, fry bust your SH.
Seven kids look at each other, hands over mouths, eyes wide open, in disbelief, embarrassment, giddiness.
kinds of friends? Can't I tie it neat in a bow with ends? Or a knot?
The Acunt of Swaps.
Acunt of Swaps. Does he like new cream and hate men's pies? When he looks at the sun, does he wink his eyes? Or not?
The Acunt of Swaps.
The Acunt of Swaps.
With a smiley bump, gonna line him up. And the question I ask, hey, look at me, that's my answer.
Perhaps one of the most interesting words in the English language today is the word fuck.
Does he teach his subjects to roast and bake?
Out of all of the English words that begin with the letter F, fuck is the only word that is referred to as the F word. It's the one magical word. Just by its sound can describe pain, pleasure, hate, and love. Fuck, as most words in the English language, is derived from German, the word frichen, which means to strike.
I get mad at my parents sometimes when they say it because I have two younger siblings, and I think that it's just better if for little kids, they don't learn it when they're younger.
What age do you think when you say little kids, what age is okay to know those words?
I think that around when you get like in maybe third grade or fourth grade, that's a good age to actually know what the words mean because you're smarter.
Do you think there are any kids today who haven't heard these words?
I'm probably like a newborn baby, but like a newborn baby that's still in your mom's stomach, but well, the babies that can't talk probably know it, but just can't talk, I think, too.
And the research also shows that kids use the words in exactly the same way that adults do.
In English, fuck falls into many grammatical categories.
Moments of frustration.
As a transitive verb for
emphasis.
For instance.
Or in moments of surprise.
John fucked Shirley.
In jokes.
As an intransitive verb.
Or in anger.
Shirley fucks.
No difference.
Its meaning's not always sexual.
Like when I get into a bad mood, cause my cousin, he broke something of mine yesterday, and I had got mad, and I didn't mean to curse, and it just slipped out. I said, you effing idiot, you broke my D stuff. And then I had got in trouble.
It can be used as an adjective, such as, John's doing all the fucking work.
Well, me and my friends, we always talk, and sometimes when you're in an argument with somebody, you take it too far, and then you just want to say, dude, what the H is your problem? Or, you know, there's just things you want to say.
I think I used the first curse word when I was 8.
As part of an adverb, Shirley talks too fucking much.
Because someone got me real mad and I was in an argument with my friend, and then I was like, you effing B, why don't you get out of my effing face?
As an adverb enhancing an adjective, Shirley is fucking beautiful.
What did it feel like to use those words for the first time?
Well, sort of. I felt relieved because
She actually listened to me. She actually got out of my face and stuff.
As a noun, I don't give a fuck.
You cuss when you like hurt yourself and it really hurts. I'm sure you cuss, don't you? Do you?
I have been known to cuss.
Because you can't, you're a dog. You have to let yourself free sometimes.
As part of a word, abso-fucking-lutely.
This has great relevance to the law.
Or in-fucking-credible.
In the past, the Supreme Court has said that the FCC is right to keep words off radio and television if hearing the words could, quote, enlarge a child's vocabulary in an instant.
And, as almost every word in a sentence, fuck the fucking fuckers.
And that's one of the justifications cited by the FCC in the Bono decision. Quote, we believe that even isolated broadcasts of the F word in situations such as that here could do so as well, in a manner that many, if not most parents, would find highly detrimental and objectionable.
I'm not even sure that most parents would find it detrimental if you've got 60% of your parents using this kind of language in the home. I mean, why would it be more detrimental to hear it on TV than to hear your mom or dad say that kind of stuff?
As you must realize, there aren't too many words with the versatility of fuck, as in these examples describing situations such as fraud. I got fucked at the used car lot.
Has anybody studied the actual thing that the FCC is regulating, which is what is the effect of seeing certain words or seeing certain things referred to on television and radio? What is the effect of that on children's development and behavior?
Dismay. Oh, fuck it.
The closest we've come to that, there's people who have been studying the effects of kids watching violent television and playing violent video games, and the closest they get to language is looking at rap music and the lyrics in rap music. And those studies show it doesn't have harm like watching violence. That's been clearly linked, correlated with later incidents of verbal or physical aggression, but words, no.
Trouble. I guess I'm really fucked now.
The commission in this decision said, I'm reading from their decision, the F word is one of the most vulgar, graphic, and explicit descriptions of sexual activity in the English language. Its use invariably invokes a coarse sexual image. The implication of this is that when Bono says effing brilliant, the five commissioners of the FCC actually are picturing, you know, penises and vaginas. Its use invariably invokes a coarse sexual image. Is there any evidence that when people say, you know, effing brilliant or use the F word in this kind of way, that anyone else in America is picturing a coarse sexual image?
Aggression. Don't fuck with me, buddy.
No.
Difficulty. I don't understand this fucking question.
I have done my master's thesis and dissertation on how people interpret taboo words, and usually we think of them connotatively, so...
This is Parental Guidance Radio.
Inquiry. Who the fuck was that?
There is a part of our government that is charged with enforcing politeness.
So, You do think of the emotional overtones of the word. You don't think of it in its denotative meaning. That's a kind of one of the unique things about this word. If you said the effing good convention, people wouldn't think it was a convention where you had intercourse. They would think it meant it was a really good convention.
Dissatisfaction. I don't like what the fuck is going on here.
effing brilliant, it doesn't bring up the what the word denotes. It brings up the emotional.
Incompetence.
I have no sympathy for that whatsoever.
He's a fuck off.
And I've asked that question for 30 years. It's the same question. Aren't we going to hell in a handbasket because somebody said the F word?
Dismissal. Why don't you go outside and play hide and go fuck yourself?
But I don't know what people thought, but common people talked in Chaucer's time or Shakespeare's time. But, you know, I think this language has been around forever. And I think we're, on the other hand, I think we're a more civil society. I mean, we have laws now against harassment at work and discrimination at work where, you know, racial minorities and women were, you know, were excluded from a lot of places in our culture.
Wait, you're saying there's more civility now than there was 100 years ago?
I'm sure you can think of many more examples. With all of these multi-purpose applications, how can anyone be offended when you use the word? We say, use this unique, flexible word more often in your daily speech. Identify the quality of your character immediately.
Yeah.
Say it loudly and proudly.
I don't think swearing is part of some coarsening trend.
Fuck you!
At the end of the day, we haven't, as a commissioner, nor do I think as a government, seen very many studies that have documented the causal link between kind of indecency and what happens to its impact on children.
I, Lattice, a wolf of garden of traffic, survive a dawn. Pick up again, a dirty worn, spit it out. What kind of life is to live? Spit it up when life is cheap.
Stomp out the un-American critter, says a fat frog-faced southern doctor who's been drinking corn out of a mason jar. He advances drunkenly, then halts.
Made of hickory with a light rosewood finish.
Old by the formidable size and menacing aspect of the centipede. That's ghastly, fellows. We gotta burn the son of a bitch like an ebony negro. I'm not sticking my neck out, me, says a cool, hip young doctor high on LSD 25. Why, a smart DA could fade out. Order in the court. DA. Gentlemen of the jury, these learned gentlemen claim that the innocent human creature they have so wantonly slain suddenly turned himself into a huge black centipede. And it was their duty to the human race to destroy this monster before it could, by any means at its disposal, perpetrate its kind.
Cities have fallen for words.
Fucked over.
Thundering words.
Modified, mechanistic, arm, disarm, find a word. Armistice? Now explain. Dashed in semantics, only place is to live.
The strongest word is still the word free.
Inside others torment. All response, tinny, forlorn, knee-jerk, liberal, recoils in hounded, night sound, horror-battered, limb torn from limb. How won't any speak?
Are we to gulp down this tissue of horseshit?
I know how you were. You were so about love. You thought it would never end.
Next to the word free, the best word is new.
We're so crazy. Thought it would never, ever end.
James
eyes like a greased and nameless asshole? Where is this wondrous centipede? We have destroyed it, they say smugly. And I would like to remind you, gentlemen and hermaphrodites of the jury, that this great beast, he points to Dr. Schaefer, has, on several previous occasions, appeared in this court, charged with the unspeakable crime of plain rape. In plain English, he pounds the rail of the jury box. In plain English, gentlemen, forcible lobotomy. The jury gasps. One dies of a heart attack. Three fall to the floor, writhing at orgasms of prurience.
A white shirt, good boarded in Beverly Hills, in a men's shop in Beverly Hills in 1981 on the Red Night Tour. It was his best shirt. All the other
Western or don't
be
tennis or have play toys.
It had been tight and lost a lot of weight. He thought it looked fit. A necktie, hand painted by William. Moroccan vest, green velvet with a gold brocade trim. Given him by Brian Geisen 25 years before. In his lapel buttonhole, the rosette of the French government's Commandeur d'Art, and the rosette of the American Academy of Arts and Letters, honors which William very much appreciated.
God of Ari, Verte Showers, and Grant I Grace, Amen. Will we spread them here now? Aye, we will. Spread on your bank, and I'll spread mine on mine. But it's what I'm doing, spread. It's churn and shield, their wind is rising. I lay a few stones on the hostile sheet, a man and his bride embrace between them, else I'd have folded and sprinkled them only. And I'll tie my butcher's apron here. It's suity yet the strollers will pass it by. Six shifts. 10 kerchiefs, 9 to hold to the fire, and 1 for the coal.
You know, it's kind of hard for the Federal Communications Commission to have to weigh what its actual impact is on children, and that's more of Congress's job. For us, you know, we have a law that's been in place for 70 years that we, by statute, are forced to implement.
How about making it Virius de Latin, Ludius Maximus, and Pectoralis Majors knightly? Now that's clean. To you, schmuck, but it's dirty to the Latins. Well, you just can't put pits and ass up here, that's all.
One of Biddy's beads went bobbing till it rounded up lost history with a marigold and a cobbler's candle.
And, you know, we're kind of, our hands are a little tied in the area, and in all areas in which, you know, our job is to enforce the laws that Congress writes.
Let's talk about the Golden Globe decision.
Sure.
And I understand that you can only talk about this to a limited extent because you guys have a kind of appeal that's up in front of the commission still, right? Okay, just to review for people what happens in that case.
Sure.
Bono gets this award in an award show. He uses the F word. The FCC says basically the F word deserves special treatment and special restrictions in its use. And the reason that it gives in the decision is this. The F word is one of the most vulgar, graphic, and explicit descriptions of sexual activity in the English language. Its use invariably invokes a coarse sexual image. It seems like what the commissioners are saying is that when Bono says effing brilliant, they're saying that the problem with this word and the reason why it deserves special scrutiny under law is that literally they're picturing, you know,
right,
an actual act.
Right.
You have to give us something. La Nouvelle Vague, La Parisienne, the Follies class with ass, I'll buy that.
Thank you.
dirty word this and dirty word that.
Scream or whimper, act safe, stop!
A gold coin in his pants pocket. A gold 19th century Indian head $5 piece symbolizing all wealth.
He points dramatically.
He would have enough money to buy his way in the underworld.
He it is, he and no other, who has reduced whole provinces of our fair land to a state bordering on the far side of idiocy. He it is who has filled great warehouses with row on row, tier on tier of helpless creatures who must have their every want attended. The drones, he calls them, with a cynical leer of pure educated people. Gentlemen, I say to you that the wanton murder of Clarence Cowie must not go unavenged. This foul crime shrieks like a wounded faggot for justice at least. Centipede is rushing about in agitation.
Dictionary of a language in which each word would be translated into French order by several words when necessary by a whole sentence.
Well, let's get something patriotic, maybe. Like the most American girls in the world. American tits and ass? Yeah. Grandma Moses tits and Norman Rockwell's ass.
Translation of French words or of French or other sentences.
Paul, enough! The unconscionable act means of headlines written in blood.
Find how to classify this girl. Alphabet, or rather a few elements.
Norman Rockwell's ass, draw my ass and win a Buick.
Line, circle, etc. Proceed, which will vary.
Soon, though, they'll have a big nibble up on the marquee, and guys will be playing like Harpo Marx.
Is it speaker? No. Relation to shorthand. Grammar. That is, how to connect the elementary signs like words, then the groups of signs one to the other. What will become of the ideas of action, of being, verb, of modulation, adverbs, etc. Buy a dictionary and cross out the words to be crossed out, signs, revise and correct.
Very small, when break and said, was the beat for the rebels. Say that love so much that cannot let go. So had to rape. So did it. Felt whole lot of pain and had a gun. So told that should not even cry. Whenever cry will kill. So did it begin to feel pain in stomach.
This is Word Receptacle on Over the Edge tonight, KPFA, KPFB, Berkeley, KFCF Fresno, KZFR in Chico.
I don't know that it's what they picture. I mean, I think part of that decision, though, is that the word in and of itself, kind of maybe for the young who think about it, that's what it means.
Persuasive words.
Muslim child raped and dying
was for saying fuck you to one of my classmates because she wouldn't show me her book on St. Catherine. And she gave me a dirty look back and sort of sugar fizzed at me. And when she saw that wasn't having enough of effect, she went up to the teacher and instantly she was able to summon some tears and got all traumatic. And the teacher turned bright red and grabbed me by the arm and half lifted me up and took me to the principal, who was a nun, and then they double teamed me, and it was an ugly sight. One eighth grader versus two vicious women and one crying eighth grade girl. And it's funny how even words that weren't dirty, like retard, I think there was that Salt and Pepper song, and they said something about having sex and moaning like a retard, and...
Enlightening words.
Hey, you ever fucking nun?
Masticate. Turgid. Boneless.
Yeah,
Kumquat. Whippet. Cockix.
Good, hello.
Dongo. Muckluck.
No.
Eno.
Serial killers.
Boo Goo.
Justin Helzer.
Uranus.
Convicted.
Alcatraz.
Yeah, Justin got convicted.
Wrong.
Koa.
Don Godman.
I hope the weatherman is listening.
Wiggle. Justin Helzer, a prop out god.
He wouldn't listen to a show like this.
Oh,
he'd be all embarrassed and giggling.
Person.
Vitriolic words.
Let me be the first to say it's not over. God has work, you will see, it will be done.
Yeah, you know, Dan, I don't know why you want to play all these dirty words, this and dirty words, that, when you know, you think it's
off the alcohol, don't.
Why don't you play some good?
Some what? Some what?
Gun.
Frog. Industrial goth.
I like gun better anyway. Hey.
You're not the weatherman.
No, fuck you.
No.
I made you, you dumb fuck.
Oh, I know where you live, buddy.
That's right, you're a dumb fucking fuck.
Uh-huh. You think so?
See, I, Adrian, I don't care what you say. I don't care what you say at all.
Anal? No. I would just like to talk about Ivan Stein.
Annihilate.
Enunciation. Delta. Non-antioxidant.
But I'll tell you, Adrian, even if there was no FCC, I'd be cutting you off.
I believe so.
You gotta ask yourself, why?
Who? Where? And when?
This guy, I'm sure.
No, but believe me, it will happen. It's not over.
Right on over. You meet Mrs. Smith, Mr. Weston, and me.
You have not heard the Helzer. You will rise again like on the seventh day.
I will fight for my country, and I'll defend this
die for your country.
And I'll stare at the whites of your soldiers' eyes
when
with a Kalashnikov in my hand.
You just wait.
When you break down the doors of my neighbors, and when you say that your might makes right,
a small thing.
When you say
that you're 11th and July 7th, 2004.
When you say that you're looking for terrorists in their bedrooms late at night. Asbestos.
They're in the spider holes.
When you torture my brother at gunpoint on his...
Let us have might!
Mount Diablo. In the Concord Naval Weapons Station.
It makes faith right.
Come with way. Your tank.
Remember, you are all done.
Human words.
When you say these streets are yours.
And once more, please.
When you say you rebuild us with bombers. And your oil tankers cover our shores.
A very small thing.
And when you gun down my child in Fallujah.
Scathing words.
You needn't wonder why. I look through you, through the blades of my coffer, and say today's a good day to die.
There was a note of pleading in that last, seemingly.
Right.
And just a little quieter expression of your fate.
Let us have right might. That makes might right.
I will fight for my country. I'll defend my land. And I'll stare at the whites of your soldiers' eyes with a Kalashnikov in my hand.
But the rationale is so strange. I mean, they're saying that the reason why it's important to do it is because the use of this word in any context invokes this coarse sexual image. And if you think about how it's used, for example, Pat Tillman, the football player who was killed in Iraq,
right.
His brother at a memorial service saying he's effing dead. So, like, that clearly does not invoke a coarse sexual image for
humble words
for anyone.
Sarcastic words.
And so the premise of the ruling seems to be questionable.
Well, part of that is to be frank, is as I think NBC argued and some of the recon petitions argued, and we will have to look at again, you know, when these words are used as intensifiers as opposed to, you know, in a sexual context. But I think you're right, the commission at that point felt, boy, when you use this word and you're a kid, I don't know that there is such thing as an intensifier. I think, you know, it is kind of the utmost, it is the word at the top of the list.
Grateful words.
And that is kind of the basis of the decision.
It's kind of a weird justification.
Again, you know, and that will be the subject of the recon.
The recon. That is the petition for reconsideration.
No, Leonardo Fibonacci.
How long ago was that?
Back in medieval times. See, what the Fibonacci do is pretty simple. He started with one, and adding one to itself, he got two.
Yeah, that is pretty simple.
Ah, but then he had one, next to two, so he said to himself, I'll take the last two numbers in the list. You know, the one next to the two.
One next to the two.
Bali. Ballad. Baltic. Banana. Barcelona. Barometer. Barometric.
Ruthlessly shot down, degraded, body beyond recognition.
The best of Pardon My Boner, Volume 8. Newscasts are often presented live.
And here's a story from the Pardon My Boner newsroom. In Chicagoland today, a woman slipped and fell on the asshole.
Asphalt. Oh, shit, I said asshole. Oh, goddammit, I said shit.
Inspirational words. Happy words.
A child? Silence from Mars. Days dying silent from Satan's world. Plague of silence damned to nose.
Trenchant words. Expressive words. Pointed words.
Glimpsely, dead of tongue, a harangue. Humanity is chaining, subjugated, bent to obfuscate. Well-meaning crunch of any other.
Thundering words.
Five death squadrons annihilate the senses. What mouth now to suffocate?
Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. We shall fight on the beaches, we shall fight in the hills, we shall never surrender.
And then the three next to the two.
Open presented live.
And here's a story from the Pardon My Boner newsroom. In Chicagoland today, a woman slipped and fell on the asshole.
Asphalt. Oh, shit, I said asshole.
Five. The five next to the three would give him eight. And kept playing with the numbers. 13, 21, 34, 55, 89.
Sounds like a waste of time.
Well, that's what I thought.
Cute.
Well, that he didn't have anything better to do.
Word receptacle on Over the Edge tonight. KPFA, KPFB, Berkeley, KFCF, Fresno, KZFR, and Chico.
I should point out here that the FCC's own staff initially ruled that when Bono said effing brilliant, it did not have any sexual connotation. And for that reason, it was not indecent. And it was the commissioners, the guys at the top, who went back and reopened the case.
There was a note of pleading, seemingly, and make it more a positive statement of your being. Take
faith. Right. Right. Let us have faith. That faith makes might. Right.
This is Parental Guidance Radio.
Wouldn't it be wonderful if we could record our dreams? And then in our wake, see where we were in our sleep. What curious things we said and saw. What curious things we did. How we played at love with all its wildness, weakness, and woe. And we played at believing in gods and observing the ordinances for your sake, in impossible codes, thinking our lives unique, quite quainter than usual kinds. We held that we could not abide a week the tether of typical minds. The people who day by day pass by us and look at us from over the wall in a casual way never know and feel, if anything, that nobody's here. No twain who in heart heaves prove themselves at all adept, who more than many laughed and loved, who more than many wept, or were sprites or elves into blind matter hurled, or ever could have been to themselves the center of the world. Minerva GV, the center of the world.
Buddy, you're a boy, make a big noise, playing in the street, gonna be a big man someday. You got mud on your face, big disgrace, kicking your can all over the place, singing wee woo wee. Gonna take on the world someday. You got blood on your face, big disgrace, waving your banner all over the place, singing we will rock you. We will rock you. Buddy, you're an old man, poor man, pleading with your eyes, gonna make you some peace someday. You got mud on your face, big disgrace, somebody better put you back into your place. And we will rock you. We will rock you. We will rock you. We will rock you.
Two.
Preposition. Two is a preposition.
Come is a verb.
It's interesting to see how many women are brought before the public now on television and in movies as stand-up comics. And I think part of what we get there is this boundary breaking. We have not only a man using language that had been taboo for public presentation, but now women talking about sex and talking in a way that we hadn't done before. But Lenny Bruce is an important door opener indeed.
Two is a preposition, come is a verb. Two is a preposition, come is a verb.
You stoop down and say, come.
Verb intransitive.
It's interesting, the authors talk about, in understandably righteous terms, about the chilling effect that his arrest had and expressing outrage that he was arrested. But in a certain way, if he hadn't been arrested, I mean, the fact that he was arrested was a measure of the fact that these were real taboos.
To come.
In a quiet tone, hold out your hand and snap your fingers. If he runs from you, step backward or turn away from him, and he will think you are leaving and will follow you.
To come. I've heard these two words my whole adult life, and as a kid when I thought I was sleeping. To come. To come. It's been like a big drum solo.
While if you approach the dog, he thinks he is to be punished and will turn away to avoid being caught.
Whereas today, you know, other than Bill Maher maybe, nobody really pays much price for breaking boundaries.
Did you come? Did you come good? Did you come good? Did you come good?
Let him set the pace. And don't force him to play if he seems drowsy or disinterested.
Come good. Did you come good?
Always let him come to you.
Did you come good? Did you come good? Did you come good? Without teeth, I come better with you, sweetheart, than anyone in the whole goddamn world.
Well, I think there is an impulse to shock that can become decadent. I think there's a self-involvement, especially when driven by commercial purposes.
Everybody came so good.
Ernie came so good because I love you.
Encourage him constantly. No coaxing here.
Pretty came so good.
If he hasn't learned to come to you,
by stooping down, gently pulling on the lounge.
I come better with you, sweetheart, than anyone in the whole world. Everything came so good.
And say come.
So good.
Until he has mastered this command.
But don't come in me. Don't come in me. Don't come in me, me. Don't come in me, me. Don't come in me. Don't come in me, me. Don't come.
Bend with
your right hand, push him down gently but firmly on his hindquarters until he sits, and say the word sit. Put a hand on his head and walk around him counterclockwise, repeating stay or hold it.
I can't come. Because you don't love me, that's why I can't come.
If he starts to get up, press him back with your right hand. Gradually increase the circles without touching his head.
I love you, I just can't come. That's my hang-up.
Take him inside. A long hallway is an excellent place
to see if we can...
Sit down on the grass and have him come to you by saying, come.
I can't come and I'm loaded, all right? Because you don't love me. Just what the hell is the matter with you? What has that got to do with loving you? I just can't come, that's all. Now, if anyone in this room or the world finds those two words decadent...
I don't know, wear clothes that are just so revealing that, or move in such a way that will can be nothing that will shock
or
the public.
Or slice cows apart and stick them in
yeah.
galleries.
Right, right.
Obscene.
I mean, what about that? And that's obviously the last 50 years of boundary breaking to the degree it's been defined as this. Let's freak out the orthodoxies and the pillars of convention.
Immoral, amoral, asexual.
Can that become too much of a kind of default impulse on the part of artists, do you think?
He will soon catch on.
Words to come really make me feel uncomfortable.
However, if he is distracted by birds flying or other outside noises, take him inside. A long hallway is an excellent place.
If you think I'm rank for saying it to you, you're the beholder gets rank for listening to it.
Have him sit down, place the object in his mouth, and say, take it.
You probably can't come.
With your hand over his mouth, stroke under his chin, and say, hold. When you take the object out of his mouth, say, give. And when you throw it, say, fetch, or go get it. And after he has picked it up, say, come. And have him bring it to you.
Well, I do think there's a point where we get to bad taste and self-indulgence and decadence. I don't want to be a censor, and I'm much more comfortable turning away with.
This is Parental Guidance Radio.
At the urging of a lobbying group, I declared that effing brilliant means sex.
About making the show stop.
We did ask the 9 to 12-year-olds we interviewed around Chicago what Bono might mean by the phrase effing brilliant. None of them saw it the way the commissioners did.
Well, I think he meant that it was a really great award that he got.
Yeah, I think he was just really happy and wanted to express his feelings.
It's a word that you use when you're either very something. If you're very happy, I guess you use that. If you're very sad or very angry with someone, you use that. He was very proud of his award, and he was exaggerating brilliant by just using effing.
Decision, the FCC explicitly puts broadcasters on notice that it is changing the legal definition of profanity. In the past, the commission gave some weight to the idea of context. The F word and other potentially offensive material could sometimes be allowed on the air if it was in a context that had some redeeming value, if it was in a news report, for instance. But with these recent decisions, the FCC has moved the line on where context counts. Now they're saying the rule is, if a word is deeply offensive to some members of the public, or the commission thinks that hearing the word might enlarge a child's vocabulary, that could be enough to overrule context.
Thank you.
So the line is moved. Though exactly where it is moved to is not totally clear yet. For instance, the Bono decision declared that now even euphemisms for the F word, which presumably include the phrase the F word, are probably illegal, not to the time. In our interview, John Cody of the FCC made a point of saying that context does still count. Pointed to page 5 of the Bono decision, where the commissioners specifically say that if there is, quote, political, scientific, or independent value, the stuff you're broadcasting might be okay.
And I think that it's important, to me it's important to realize that somebody like Dick Gregory, somebody like Lenny Bruce, Richard Pryor, are part of a process of loosening up American Victorianism.
The sort of shock troops of the culture?
They are. And they're also getting us more and more accustomed to one another.
There is still wiggle room now. For instance, you know, we did not overrule the Branson case, which is an old, I believe, NPR case with the Gotti tapes, in which, you know, he uses the F word over and over. And
yeah, let's just explain what that is. That's a case where NPR had a wiretap of John Gotti and used it in a news report. This is back in the 80s.
Right.
And didn't beep out the F word. And somebody complained to the FCC, and the FCC said, no, it's okay in this context because there's a clear news value to this. And you're saying that this decision did not overturn that?
That's right. That's still good law, in fact. And I think what the decision really stands for at the end of the day is gratuitous uses that don't have kind of a newsworthy reasoning behind them.
You, Mom?
You know, are more in the indecent camp than not.
One of the things that's happening is that I think a lot of broadcasters are having to guess what's going to be okay under the laws.
Hello.
It should all be okay.
I know a guy who used to collect hellos. Hello.
Ken? Is that you, Ken?
Call someone up.
Like,
since the Bono ruling.
And they'd say, hello. Hello. And that's all they'd have to hear.
Or even a little urine time.
Recently, another public radio show, Fresh Air, faces decision where there's a singer named Nellie McKay who uses the word sock in a song, and not in sort of a sexual connotation, more in the connotation of kind of like that sucked sort of thing.
S-U-C-K.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And the producer of Fresh Air went to the lawyers for and they basically said, like, are we okay? And they said, absolutely not. Like, that's just too risky.
Apologize so much that it's jive, it's a crutch I just use when I'm judged, being fudged by a face I can't erase and can't see, cause I'm misplaced to Dossier or Monty Python CD or something stupid like that. But Jesus, is that so bad to make my ego go splat like a tire going flat or fat on a Big Mac? I'm being attacked, if it's that, you fucking bureaucrats, you can just apologize back.
Yeah, I mean, my personal opinion is I think it's a little bit of an overreaction on the broadcaster side, while understandable. I mean, again, they take these things very seriously, and they have to first and foremost think about their audience and their licenses, and they don't want to put them at risk.
But I don't know when it comes and it goes, all the highs and the lows, and this motionless cycle system,
and all kinds of hellos.
Hello?
Some highs.
Hi, this is Kevin.
Hi. Who is it? Hi.
Leave a message.
Hello. Hello.
I could thank you.
Give me big shoes. Title from Nike TV commercial for hiking shoes, shot in Kenya using Samburu tribesmen. Camera closes in on tribesman who speaks his native language, Ma. As he speaks, the slogan, Just Do It, appears on the screen. Lee Kronk, anthropologist at the U of Cincinnati, says the man is really saying, I don't want these. Give me big shoes. Says Nike's Elizabeth Dolan, we thought nobody in America would know what he said.
I'm sorry for the mess, the stupid way I'm dressed. I guess I failed my test, oh don't you know I'm sorry for my views. I must have been confused, and yet you know that really
Give me big shoes. In Western shoes, to die and go out in's an easy religion. As useful as dead rat in refrigerator. So delete the Messiah strain, but do not question prudent joy. Sometimes fit to burst with amour. Think doting, think of Think Life, Inc. This version is the difficult sane. Collective person enmeshed in last bizarre utopianism, human time spent maintaining dictionaries on platonic porch. Response that looks like door then becomes more intense. Snow moon questions dwindle, pick up gaze from window.
Inside my brain.
Do you think that when people say these bad words, are they paying homage to the person who first thought it up? Or are they just making it tired and unfunny? I did some research to find out
what qualifies
these people. And I'm going to post these findings with this following graph.
Play hide and seek.
The results were surprising. The graph above suggests that 6,367,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000, Chappelle.
One among the shapes begins to play.
I do think that we've needed humorous ethnic and national types, as brutal as they can be. I was one of those who did not want the Amos and Andy shows cut off because I found them hilarious, but also because it seems to me that people who are not black looking at these shows not only begin to see everybody black as Amos and Andy, I think there was some of that, but I also think they're identifying with humanly funny situations. And through that process of identification, we become more accustomed to one another.
Child of scorn, and that's where you are.
I'm sorry for you.
Well, now I don't mean to offend
much.
Just comprehend when you're female and you're fencing and fen to no end. And no Zen guide you men will help you fend off the brethren. And then the pen appears, and then the oxygen network, or the sword of spirit fork, or the board fork fed horde. It's a mooring post, the whore you'll miss the most when you're away. When you're in snowshoe PA, doing some play from backstage. Gays, relationships, and ballet. And then you're like, hey, hey, what'd you say? I can just sing my troubles away. But then you're fucked, cause you gotta make a buck, and the whole world sucks, and you're an ugly duck that's dying line. Kind of slow, there's no one fine, as old as doubt. Capreen and dream and scream and chop your life's afflictions, fiction of fouls.
But I don't know when it comes and it goes, all the highs and the lows, and this motion of cycles, this and I.
Leading us to Harry Carey. It's like a mythology, almost like a malingering ghost. As we slowly decompose, rotting in the grave of the polls, crying for Senator Wellstone, and then proceeding to moan at our own supposed sabotage of the elections at home.
Oh, somebody phone home. The American people have spoken.
Now, is that certain? Maybe those nice Midwestern folks are just joking. In any case, we're easing dope and choking, moping and sobbing. Come on, you disheartened dobbin. Saying sorry is my problem, so include him a little of food. There's room for me to have to allude to all this rude, crude, rubble baggage, but I manage, because I'm a savage inside. I'm listening to any trace hits and trying to control my hits even with pride. Look at my hair dyed, but all the others of Lionel, and I don't want to say
die, motherfucker!
But I wouldn't mind if you did. Janet Reno has no ego when devoured by the id. So before I flip my lip by crippling myself to this bind, you can hear what's on my lip, but you don't know what's in my mind.
I'm sorry for the mess, the stupid way I'm dressed. I guess I failed my test, oh, don't you know I'm sorry for my views. I don't know how to schmooze, and yet you know that really I'm
sorry for you.
Awani Jolly Fanto Blumba O Fali Hambla Grossiga Mapla Habla Horami Gaga Goldman High Globlo Icora Sulo Huju Holaka Holala Alogobang Blagobang Blagobang Baso Futaka.
And I understand that. You know, I hear this a lot from the broadcast community, which is just tell us what the rules are. You know, show us, give us bright line rules. But I don't know that you want the government to write a red book on what you can say and not say.
We do not all mean the same thing.
I just think that that gets into a very dangerous situation.
But in using the same word, we do not all mean the same thing.
But on the other hand, you know, not issuing a red book and saying it, you know, also does a kind of damage because people are forced to guess and tend to, you know, they'll overreach, as in this case.
Well, that might be right. I mean, you know, and like you said, it's overreaching. I mean, I think with time, what is likely to happen is you're going to see the commission do the opposite, which is, you know, it's going to deny some of these cases and give broadcasters, you know, more and more precedent by which to go by. Over time.
When the decision says political, scientific, or independent value, could independent value also be, you know, literary value?
Of course.
Yeah.
Of course.
Be each of us. days of old.
It's funny because there's a David Sedaris story that we ran on our show years ago that takes place in a bathroom. That violates all three of the FCC criteria for indecency. It's explicitly graphic in talking about excretory activities, which is one of the criteria.
Right.
He repeats and dwells on the descriptions at length. Because he's trying to be funny,
right?
And he absolutely means to pander and shock, like that's the joke of it,
right?
Way. So it violates all three standards. And my understanding was that kind of today we'd really could get in trouble for that because context might not protect us.
Well, I think we would look at the context, but I think, you know, you might have given away the, again, I'm not familiar with it, but you might have given away the context in that he's trying to be funny as opposed to be, you know, is he talking about, you know, irritable bowel syndrome in a health conscious way, or is he just trying to crack jokes? I mean, I think that's the kind of the distinction that...
Can I play this for you? It's only 2 minutes long, and if you at the end of it, you feel like, oh, you can't actually...
Yeah, I'm not going to be able to... But I'll let you play it. And,
all right, let me play it and then see
sure.
If you have anything you can say about
sure.
it. Here we go.
We had Easter dinner at John's house, a big afternoon meal which we ate in his backyard. Everyone had taken their places at the table when I excused myself to visit the bathroom, and there, in the toilet, was the absolute biggest turd I have ever seen in my life. No toilet paper or anything, just this thick and coiled specimen. I flushed the toilet and the big turd roused around. It budged and bobbed a little, but that was it. This thing wasn't going anywhere. Just then, someone knocked on the door and I started to panic. Just a minute! At an early age, my mother sat me down and explained that everyone has bowel movements. Everyone, she said. Even the president and his wife. Everyone in the world. Everyone but me. And I could picture them all, everyone from Red Skelton to Lady Bird Johnson, but something this big, just a minute! And I seriously considered lifting this turd out of the toilet and tossing it out the window. I honestly considered it, but John lives on the ground floor and a dozen people were seated at a picnic table 10 feet away. And these were people who would surely investigate and gather around, and there I'd be trying to explain that it wasn't mine. But why would I bother throwing it out the window if it wasn't mine? No one would have believed me. Just a minute! And I scrambled for the plunger and used it to break the turd into manageable pieces. And even then, I had to flush twice just to get rid of it. It was Janet at the door, and she said, well, it's about time. And I was left thinking that the person who left the huge turd had no problem with it. So why did I? And later, at the table, I examined each guest. Trying to figure who is capable.
Anyway.
You know, I mean, it's hard to say, but it kind of goes back to, you know, it's an area in which there is a lot of gray.
See, but I would argue this one on just straight up literary merit. If you think about the mission of literature, it's to describe situations that we all can relate to and have had some feeling of ourselves or can imagine having a feeling of. And that seems to be what he's doing.
I don't disagree with you. And, you know, we would take that segment that you had just produced, and the reason you aired it is for, in part, news value, right? I mean, you know, you're conducting an interview with a public official, and you're trying to explain to your audience kind of the state of indecency law. I mean, again, that would be factors we would have to take into consideration. I mean, those are the types of things that I think the commission has and will continue to take in consideration when we talk about kind of context. You know, we're outside of the kind of isolated word, you know, gratuitous use of the F word here. You know, we're in that gray area, and I would say in an area of the gray that from, you know, traditionally has been more on the not indecent side than indecent. So,
but
this is Parental Guidance Radio.
Essentially, my little cells go giddy glad with sudden kinds of going mad. When swords were bright and steeds were prancing, the vision of a warrior bold would sit in dancing. Miniver sighed for what was not, dreamed and rested from his labors. He dreamed of Thebes and Camelot and Priam's neighbors. Miniver mourned the ripe renown that made so many a name so fragrant. He mourned romance now on the town and art a vagrant. Miniver loved the Medici, albeit he had never seen one. He would have sinned incessantly, could he have been one. Miniver cursed the commonplace, and eyed a khaki suit with loathing. He missed the medieval grace of iron clothing. Miniver scorned the gold he sought, but sore annoyed was he without it. Miniver thought, and thought, and thought, and thought about it.
Bengal. Renard.
Also thinking about what the Supreme Court says. The Supreme Court says, well, another problem is, you know, teaching a kid a word. If we teach a kid a word, then that's a problem. But in this, you know, I don't think any kid would be learning any words from this. And in fact, I have to say, this is a little monologue that, like, a seven-year-old would love.
There's no question. Again, you're right to kind of be questioning at the end of the day. What I think you're really questioning is the foundations of these rules and do they make sense for that medium? And I think that's the right question. And again, my personal perspective is I'd stand not just beside you, but behind you on that one, and in front of you.
Well, so in a way that, like, the best thing that can happen for the status of the law, and I sort of hate to say this, is that people would write in right now at your website, would go to www.fcc.gov and basically complain against me.
Fuck you very much, the FCC.
On this Sedaris thing, and that's the only way we would get a ruling that would sort of define the law.
Fuck you very much for fining me. $5,000 a fuck, so I'm really out of luck. That's more than Heidi Fleiss was charging me.
I certainly on that particular incident, I think that's right.
So fuck you very much, the FCC.
If the commission were to come out and say, no, that wasn't indecent, then, you know, that would go in the ledger of those cases of okay, well, this is, seemingly okay. Are these things more like this case, or are they more like the Bono case?
For proving that free speech just isn't free.
It seems the most likely outcome, if listeners complained about the story, is that the FCC would not rule at all.
Clear Channel's a dear channel, so Howard Stern must go. Attorney General Ashcroft doesn't like strong words, and so he's charging twice as much as all the drugs for Rush Limbaugh. So fuck you all so very much.
The current commissioners are much more exercised about sex than about bathroom humor. And the fact is, we did play the Sedaris story as part of a policy discussion, which makes the whole thing much more of an open and shut case for the FCC.
So fuck you very much, dear Mr. Bush, for heroically sitting on your tush. For Halliburton, Enron, all the companies who failed.
Mono at blackcycle.com. Rock and roll, baby.
Let's send them a clear signal and stick Martha straight in jail.
It would fall into a more questionable area and set more groundbreaking precedent if we just played it on its own.
She's an uppity rich bitch, and at least she is a male. So fuck you all so very much.
This is Parental Guidance Radio.
So fuck you, dickhead Mr. Cheney too. Fuck you and fuck everything you do. Your pacemaker must be a fake. You haven't got a heart. As far as I'm concerned, you're just a pasty-faced old fart.
No policy angle at all.
And as for Condoleezza, she's an intellectual tart. So fuck you all so very much.
There's no telling how that would come out.
So fuck you very much, the EPA, for giving all Alaska's oil away. It really is a bummer when I can't fill my Hummer. The ozone's a no-go zone now that Arnold's here to say
the nuclear Winter Games are going to take place in L.A.
So fuck you all so very much.
There is a bigger question in all this, and it's a question that, weirdly, Timothy J's cursing research is no help at all with. The question is this. Let's say that you agree with Timothy J's findings that show that cursing does not hurt kids. Well, then what do you do? I think most of us still would not feel very good cursing around children.
So what, the planet fails? Let's save the great white males and fuck you all so very much.
Even Timothy J tries not to curse around kids or his students or strangers for that matter, even though he's sure that it harms no one. In the same way, I think most of us wouldn't want wall-to-wall, unregulated profanity.
That lift me up and let me slip beyond the stiff of upper lip.
From across the room or across the street. And then just cooled off. Well, those people have some kind of roots in their money, I guess. About all they have got.
Shut up.
It's important to them. Why not?
It's Tada Gorame said Sumbada.
Or even now, in what I call my only hope, so tiny, small.
All over radio and television, day and night. The kids we talked to were unanimous, by the way, on this point.
Dirty word this and dirty word that.
They did not want more cursing on radio and television.
Dirty word this and dirty word that.
It gave them an odd feeling, the swearing. Listen to how a group of seven of them reacts when one of the kids, in front of an adult and a microphone, simply refers to a swear word that her mom said. She doesn't even swear.
Because she runs a daycare, and then she has said, go upstairs, for I bust your SH.
This is Parental Guidance Radio.
Seven kids look at each other, hands over mouths, eyes wide open, in disbelief, embarrassment,
giddiness.
Dirty word this and dirty word that. Dirty word this and dirty word that.
Well, I don't see what a horrible deal is of swearing, but I mean, in my opinion, I wouldn't want my grandparents to hear swear words. You know, if we were in a car and a radio, I wouldn't mind it, but I wouldn't want, you know, my grandpa or my grandma to hear the lyrics and the music that I like to listen to.
sometimes you just feel tired, feel weak. And when you feel weak, you feel like you want to just give up. But you gotta search within you. Try to find that inner strength and just pull that shit out of you. And get that motivation to not give up.
I'm out the game, huh?
Yo, Dre.
We riding.
Whatever.
Well, I'm with you, homie.
Okay. Let's handle the small shit.
I was born to brew up storms, stir up shit, kick up dust, cost till I slur up spit. Grew up too quick, went through too much, knew too much shit. Corrupt, and I'ma pour it on like syrup, bitch. Thick and rich, sick and twisted, Mr. Buttersworth. Dre told me to milk this shit for what it's worth. To the couch, just tilts and tips and stumbles the earth. And if I fumble the verse, keep going first take. I make mistakes, just keep it. No punches, pull no punches, that's weak shit, fake shit. If I ever take shit, I eat shit. Wasn't for him, wouldn't be shit.
Creep with me as we take a little trip down memory lane. Been it longer than anyone in the game. And I ain't got to lie about my age.
But what about Jermaine?
Fuck Jermaine, he don't belong speaking mine or Timberland's name. And don't think I don't read your little interviews and see what you're saying. I'm a giant and I ain't gotta move till I'm provoked. When I see you, I'ma step on you and not even know it, you midget. Mini me with a bunch of little mini yous running around your backyard swimming pools. Over 80 million records sold, and I ain't have to do it with 10 or 11 year olds.
It's what you say, it's what you say. Say what you say, how you say it whenever you saying it. Just remember how you said it when you were spraying it. So who you playing with, huh? Cause what you say is what you say. Say what you say, how you say it whenever you saying it. Just remember how you said it when you were spraying it. So who you playing with, huh? Second verse, it gets worse, it gets no better than this. Amateurs drink veteran piss from a Dixie cup. If you ever mix me up or confuse me with a cannabis, a Dre with a Dupree, we'll rub it in every club you're in. We'll have you blackballed and make sure you never rap a fucking gig. Dre ain't having it, long as I'm here to play devil's advocate.
If there was some magic shit I could wave over the industry that could save it when I'm gone and buried to make sure the tradition carries on, I would.
If I could only use this power for good, I wouldn't, not even if I could.
From the hood and I'm a hornet, and I'm a only sting when I'm cornered.
And I'm a only sucker punch and swing without warning, and swing to knock somebody's fucking head off. Cause
my nerves hurt, lately I'm on edge.
Cause I know if they get up, I won't get a chance to let off another punch on punk rock.
My nerves hurt, lately I'm on edge.
No one's punk, don't give a fuck. White pop, so much smoke. When I was little, I knew I would blow up and sell a miller, grow up.
My nerves hurt, lately I'm on edge.
To be a tiller, go nuts and be a killer.
And something of a phenom. One puff of the crown, I'm unstoppable. I'm alive and on top again. There's no obstacle that I can't conquer. So come along with us.
Come on.
Cause what you say is what you say. Say what you say, how you say it whenever you saying it. Just remember how you said it when you were spraying it. So who you playing with, huh? Cause what you say is what you say. Say what you say, how you say it whenever you saying it. Just remember how you said it when you were spraying it. So who you playing with, huh?
Now anybody who knows Dre knows I'm about fast cars and Alize. Partying all day, but I handle my business cause it's work before play. Don't look for trouble, but I serve you gourmet. However you want it, you can have it your way. You fuck my night up, I'ma fuck up your day. Bullet with your name, sending it your way. That goes for anyone who walks through that doorway. Cause this is my space, you invaded. Live to regret it, and you die trying to violate it. Fuck around, get annihilated. Eyes dilated.
Like my old lady. Cause what you say is what you say. Sometimes what you mean is two different things. Depending on your mood, if it swings. Think too many things. Little hit of Dre's weed, I can do.
Brandon, is why artists of the caliber
yes.
should resort to material which basically could be done by...
by me.
By you.
Yes.
Yes, and I mean, I don't know if you saw the play the other night on television, No Man's Land by Harold Pinter.
Yes, I did, yes.
Now, Pinter uses these words, these, I suppose to the general public, shocking words.
Yes,
but
course.
He uses them to effect.
To punctuate his...
He punctuates his dialogue.
His drama, yes.
And when he uses the word arsehole,
quite.
It means something.
Exactly.
And prick.
Yes.
And cunt.
Yes.
Take on this sort of...
Metaphysical
punctuation, which I find that
almost
delightful.
Sounds.
Especially with Gilbert and Richardson, who are so absolutely terrific.
Yes, arsehole in Richardson's mouth, it comes out as...
Pure gold. But when Cottonmore, I mean, it's not the same. I mean, prick in the hands of Pinter is as you say, a punctuation point.
Yes, an epithet.
A marvellous moment.
Yes.
The end of an extremely witty line.
Yes.
Whereas a prick or a cunt in the hands of Cuckoo-Moore, it's just a gratuitous prick or cunt.
One feels it's being abused.
It is being abused. And I myself, I cannot see why in the civilised world it is necessary for people with a certain amount of understanding of the university to use the word prick or fuck or
cunt.
I mean, I never have the slightest use the word fuck. Yes,
I mean, why do I?
Do you ever say fuck?
I never say fuck.
No, I mean, why should I say fuck? I've got no reason to say fuck.
I'd rather say carpet
than fuck. No fucking reason to say
fuck. Exactly. Who the fuck cares about fuck?
It's fucking stupid to say fuck. I mean,
exactly.
What could be more stupid than going round the whole time saying fuck and cunt and prick and arsehole and
tit
and bum? Shit, it's so stupid.
Exactly.
I mean, I'm not going to go fucking hell and shit. Tip bum arsehole, I don't need to.
Of course you're
what
not
is the
going
point? What is
yes,
the point
exactly,
of saying
what is
fuck
the point?
Shit, tip bum arsehole,
shit, cunt,
arsehole,
bum, tit,
tit,
bra,
tit,
cunt,
tits off,
oh,
fuck, tit,
shit,
bum,
arsehole,
shit,
cunt,
no,
fuck.
There is absolutely no point in saying fuck, tit, shit, bum, arsehole, cunt,
oh, fucking arsehole, shit, bum, tit, nigger, arsehole,
fuck,
oh, cunt, shit, oh, fuck,
shit, fuck,
oh, the fuck of the face, shit, fuck, cunt, nigger, fuck,
shit,
arsehole,
bum,
tit, arsehole, fuck,
cunt,
oh, jam, rag, tail, rag, fuck off the old fox, look, bum, oh, earwax, cunt, fuck, arsehole, dandruff, oh, ear, smeg, that shit, oh, fuck, bone, you, oh, fuck it up, tit, arsehole, cunt, fuck, filling, oh, cover the arsehole, bum, orifice, cunt, shove it up your arsehole, cunt,
arsehole,
who the fuck wants to say shit, arse, cunt, tear, tits off, oh, warm in the mangle, stuff your bollocks up your arse, oh,
wants
to say gland,
fuck, rooms
are like that, urethra, catheterised up your end of the arse, you don't fuck, arse,
I will be here again for Critics' Choice. Same time, next Sunday,
at 6 o'clock. Put your foot over your head, fart up your bum.
I mean, when I want to say fuck, I don't want to say radiator.
I don't want to say
radiator.
Do I want to say all of the things that I've just said?
Do you want to
say
radiator?
No, I fucking don't. I do not want to say all of the things that I have just fucking said.
Microscope would even try to get inside, to magnify that inner place where shadows play my sunshine game of hideaway. Born too late.
Well, that's about it for a word receptacle tonight. No, here's one more word. Well, there you go. Just when you need one more word, that's the kind it is. It's been Word Receptacle, Over the Edge, KPFA in Berkeley. We'll be back. Well, I shouldn't say that. Good night and good luck. Stay tuned for Puzzling Evidence. This is KPFA, KPFB, Berkeley, KFCF in Fresno. Listener-sponsored radio.
This is Grumpy Old Gamer. That was another wonderful episode of Negative Land's radio show Over the Edge. That was Word Receptacle tonight. And thank you very much for watching. And if you've made it this far, make sure you subscribe. And I will be doing more of these shows. I've got a huge library that I'll be going through eventually. So thank you for tuning in. And everybody remember, good hello.